Everything comes from God. Everything comes from Him that is beneficial. And if I want to pass on and be a conduit of God's love, His grace, His forgiveness, His truth, then I need to first be rooted in it and let that nutrients flow through me up into the plant, and then I have something to give to my children.
Welcome to the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. I'm your host, Scott Moore. Thanks for joining us today.
Good morning, Steve. How are you today?
I am well and rested. We just celebrated Easter 2 days ago.
Hallelujah. Time.
Yeah. We had the joy of helping Ethan with his four foster children sit in church because Anna was not able to be there that Sunday. She was at a family wedding. So we thought, that poor guy with four children at church. So we went, and that was an experience. You know, they're just peanuts. And they've been practicing sitting at home in family devotions. So they're getting better at it. But there's one of them that's got ants in his pants. And I totally relate to that boy because that's how I was and even still am in some way, respect. So
I was going to say, do your boys sit still in church yet?
Well, I've always been of the opinion that you learn to sit still by sitting still at home first. And we used to have family devotions at home for 20, 30 minutes. And our kids sat through church services their entire life. Yep.
Wow.
They just, yeah. Regular services, not kiddie church or whatever. They sat in regular church. But it's because I think they were used to it. So. You're still processing that.
I grew up Episcopal, so I learned to love naps.
Well, yeah. I think it's very difficult to try to expect children to sit still in church if they haven't been taught to sit still at home first. So,
fun.
Yeah. So there's free advice. But this is part of what we're going to talk about today. Tonight, I'm going to be on the Homeschool Summit, which is sponsored by the Homeschool Association in Colorado. And I'm doing a live Q&A. And the topic of the summit this year is God-centered parenting. How's that for a title?
That's some big shoes to fill.
Well, I really like the title. And the more I've meditated on it and chewed on it, I believe that that's the only way to parent is by being God-focused, God-centered. And I don't know who came up with the title, but I'm totally in on it. So tonight, I've already done a recorded broadcast, and so tonight is going to be Q&A with the audience asking questions. So this will be interesting. Pray for me if you think of me.
Will do.
So let's pray before we go any further on this one. Father, thank you for being our God, and thank you for calling us to be parents. And that's what we're counting on as parents, is that we will be God-focused and God-centered. And I pray that you give us ears to hear what you have for us today, and help us to incorporate your principles and the life of Jesus into our homes. Help us to convey what we've received from you to our children. Give us all ears to hear today in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Every good and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. James 1:17. I really like that verse because that's pretty much the first thought I had when I heard this title, God-centered parenting, is I do want to pass on to my children a love for God and a love for His word, but the only place I can receive it is from above. This morning in my daily Bible reading, I came across a verse that is not familiar to me. It's John 3:27, which says, a person cannot receive even one thing unless it is given him from heaven. Normally, when I read John 3, I'm thinking about Nicodemus being born from above. But what a line. You can't receive even one thing unless it is given him from heaven. So in order for me to pass on to my children thoughts of God, the love of God, truth of God, the grace of God, I need to be receiving it first from him. That's the thought. So are you up to speed with me now? You're tracking with me?
Yes, sir.
Because as you know, you're gonna have to supply some stuff here. So if everything good and perfect comes from above, and if I can't receive even one thing unless it is given from above, then I need to focus on above. And one of my favorite themes has been for 9 years this month has been John 15:9, as the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. John 15:9. Jesus himself, it appears, received love from the Father before he passed that love on to us. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. And we know in 1 John 4:19 that it says, we love because he first loved us. And I don't want to take out of the equation that we want to pass on forgiveness, we want to pass on grace, we want to pass on truth. But I believe love encompasses all of those, but is over all of those. And it was God so loved that he gave his son. So we're going to focus on the love aspect. And that's why I'm quoting 1 John 4:19, John 14:9. Okay, so that's first. But we're in the season of spring. Are you a gardener by any chance?
No. Only one forced.
You don't have like a green thumb hidden?
No.
No? Okay.
I have a red thumb from when I whack it with a hammer occasionally, and that's about it.
Red and purple. All right. Yeah. Well, this is the season. I've cut the grass once so far. I'm probably going to cut it again this afternoon if I get some time. And everything is growing. Everything we see is growing, because another verse that was very instrumental in my walk in 2012 is found in Ephesians chapter 3, where Paul was praying for the Ephesians church that they would be able to assimilate or take in God's love. And he prays this prayer, third chapter, and I'm breaking into the middle of it, but he says, according to the riches of his glory, he may grant you to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your heart through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love. And he goes on to talk more about that. But those words, rooted and grounded in love, they resonate with my heart, because I think of myself as a plant. I think of myself as somebody that wants to bear good fruit. I want to bear good fruit first in my family and then in my neighborhood, etc. But what I'm finding is the more I'm rooted and grounded in the love of God, the more I'm able then to bear fruit. So we're going to talk about roots a little bit. Is that all right?
Sure.
And I even did some biological studies on this. How do you like that? I learned some words. I didn't know what they meant. I almost called my son, who's got a degree in biology, and asked him to explain to me more about the concept of roots. But I'm just going to bring out a couple of different points. The first is that roots are not seen generally, mm-hmm. yet they are essential to the life of the plant. It's through the roots that the plant receives water and nutrients. That made me think of three passages in Scripture. Psalm 1, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. He is like a tree planted by streams of water that yields its fruit in its season. Its leaf does not wither, and all that he does, he prospers. Because he is like the willow tree in my backyard, which is right beside the stream. He's a tree planted by streams of water. So he's meditating on the law. He delights in the law, and he's soaking in that nutrient, that water. Isaiah 37:31 says, the surviving remnant of the house of Judah shall again take root downward and bear fruit upward. Beautiful expression. I do remember from when we studied trees in school that the growth of the tree was it was a correlation between the root system of the tree. So if the roots went down deep and strong and had a good base, then the tree could grow high and strong, etc. Jeremiah 17 kind of puts both of those scriptures together. Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, whose trust is the Lord. He is like a tree planted by water that sends out its roots by the stream and does not fear when heat comes, for its leaves remain green, and is not anxious in the year of drought, for it does not cease to bear fruit. I do believe that we're entering a time of drought. I believe that pleasant as spring is and as delightful as life is right this minute, the storm clouds are coming. The drought is ahead of us. That's just my own conviction. There's a part of me that is rejoicing in the Lord and in his goodness, and there's another part of me that's girding my loins and preparing for seasons of drought. But not only do roots take in the nutrients and the water, they also establish and make the plant firm in the soil. They provide anchorage. Hence the phrase from Ephesians 3:17, being rooted and grounded in love. Interesting that the Amplified version takes a couple more words to help us grasp that. They said, and may you, having been deeply rooted and securely grounded in love, making that point. And the only other time that that word rooted is used in the Bible is in Colossians 2, verses 6 and 7. Therefore, as you received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him, rooted and built up in him and established in the faith. So there we go again. Rooted, built up, established. So we have roots that we receive nutrients. We have roots that help us to be anchored and firm and grounded. And we have soil. And you know you've got to read this passage here, because it's found in all three of the synoptic gospels. Matthew, Mark, and Luke all have the parable of the sower. The sower sows the word. These are the ones along the path where the word is sown. When they hear, Satan immediately comes and takes away the word that is sown in them. And these are the ones sown on rocky ground, the ones who, when they hear the word, immediately receive it with joy, and they have no root in themselves, but endure for a while. Then when tribulation or persecution arises on account of the word, immediately they fall away. And others are sown among thorns. They are those who hear the word, but the cares of the world and the deceitfulness of riches and the desires for other things enter in and choke the word, and it proves unfruitful. But those that were sown on the good soil are the ones who hear the word and accept it and bear fruit 30-fold, 60-fold, and 100-fold. I've always, when I read that, I take it very seriously. May God deliver me from the cares of the world and deceitfulness of riches and the desire for things. And may he help my heart to be good soil. And I always think of a soft heart, teachable heart. A heart that is pliable enough to listen to God, and it's also a heart that is sensitive and willing to apply what he hears. And John 15:9, which I mentioned at the beginning, as the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Then he ends that verse with four words, abide in my love. And again, this to me is very consistent with the picture of roots, that these our roots have to go down deep into God's grace, deep into God's love, deep into his truth and his spirit. And we just have to be rooted and grounded in God. No getting around it.
Well, just back up a few verses and you got that whole illustration there.
What's that?
John 15, starting in 1. I am the true vine and my Father is the gardener.
Oh, keep going.
He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes so that it will be even more fruitful.
You're the man.
That's what Good I thought job. that whole chapter was what I was waiting for you to get to. And I'm like, oh, if he doesn't do this, I'm jumping on it.
you get an A.
And then there's
A plus.
And it keeps going in verse 5. I am the vine. You are the branches. If you remain in me and I remain in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing.
You know, for the first 30 years of my life, that's all I thought of was John 15 was about the vine and abiding in the vine. But for the last 9 years, I have been so focused on John 15, 9 through 12 and the rest of the chapter that I've forgotten it. So this is why we have two people on the podcast. Thank you.
Sure.
So we put it together. Abide in the vine. Whew, very good. But my experience was it was very difficult for me to abide in God's love and to be transformed by that abiding until I first believed it. And it took some effort on my part, some studies of scripture. That's where the book Knowing God's Love came from, because I had to be transformed in my thinking. I had to really believe that God was for me and that the one who knew me best loved me most, and that whole concept. And then God took me to a different level when he said, okay, now that you're solid in believing the truth, now let's spend some time together. And I began waiting on God and communing with God and experiencing his presence. But there is another verse that says, grow in the grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ, found in Peter. And I think that that's the other part of roots, is that roots don't stop. Roots continue to go down deep. In fact, in my little biological research, I think I found out that one of the largest or longest roots was something they found that was 60 meters or something ridiculous like that. It's like 200 feet. But there are certain places where there's not much moisture in the soil. Oftentimes, roots will stay near the soil. I mean, the top, because that's where the water's coming down from heaven. Unless they're next to a stream, then they can send the roots over to the water. But if you're in a rocky place or a desert place, sometimes these roots will go right down deep until they find that water. And I like that thought of being rooted and grounded. To me, is not static. It's not once I find some water, now I can chill. But I need to continue to pursue God and grow in grace and grow in knowledge. So back to our topic. The topic is God-centered parenting. And I think one of my big theses is that very difficult to give grace until you've received grace. Very difficult to give forgiveness until you've received forgiveness. Very difficult to love well until you've been loved well. So again, everything comes from above. Everything comes from God. Everything comes from him that is beneficial. And if I'm going to pass on and be a conduit of God's love, his grace, his forgiveness, his truth, then I need to first be rooted in it and let that nutrients flow through me up into the plant, and then I have something to give to my children. And that's probably the most transforming thought that I've had. I just assumed when I began having children that, you know, I'm reading my Bible every day, I had some training, I'm very involved in my church, and I just figured that now I'm just going to let what I have overflow onto my children because I have an abundance. And I wasn't intentional about my own relationship with God as much as I am now. I'm very cognizant now that I'm just going to be a much better conduit. The the more I spend time being intentional about abiding in His love, abiding in the vine, being rooted and grounded in grace. So that's my take on God-centered parenting. What do you have to add to that?
Well, just with that last piece you were saying there, I'm just remembering, you know, having little kids, and in the there's so much pressure to get it right, especially when you're trying to be a God-centered parent, and you want to be spending time with God and all that. And everybody always complains about, oh, like, how do you do this? You know, younger parents are always complaining about how do you find time to spend with God, and how do you do all this right? And they stress so much about it. And just a few minutes of trying to rest in Him and connect with Him is enough a lot of days, you know? And the other verse that came to mind for me, I'm not big on gardening, but I love fruit.
Amen. I'm with you on that.
Luke 6:43 and 44. No good tree bears bad fruit, nor does a bad tree bear good fruit. Each tree is recognized by its own fruit. So if you wonder if what you're doing is working out well, then, you know, take a look at what kind of fruit it's bearing. Now, the problem with parenting is that sometimes the fruit doesn't show up for 18 years or so, but you keep, you know, watering and trying to grow and all that. But there are glimpses of what you can check out. You know, there are little fruits that show up too. Anyway, the metaphor, it works in there, but I don't know. Does any of that make any sense?
Yeah. No, the root and the fruit are connected.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And there's even another verse in Romans 11 that says, if the root is holy, so are the branches.
Yeah.
So I really believe it's my responsibility as a parent to be rooted and grounded and keep pushing downward. And a lot of that work is going to be, as we started off, it's going to be unseen. It's not going to be measurable, but it's going to bear good fruit. So if we'll take the time, even 5 minutes, like you say, because I did have a talk on this recently, and people were asking the question, and one lady says, well, it sounds like you have a little more time than I do.
Yeah.
And I said, I am so sorry. You are absolutely correct. I do have more time, and I'm self-employed, but I, you know, so I can adjust my schedule to things, but it's very important for me. I know now that I be rooted and grounded in God, because the only way I'm going to be God-centered parenting is to be rooted in God from beginning to end. So,
amen.
Amen. Okay, let's pray. And let's pray especially for those people that are struggling to find 5 minutes or 10 minutes. And Father, there's always a way of escape. And I pray that you will help us all find the time to be rooted and grounded in God in new ways, and teach us how to do it and encourage us. And I pray that we will be like those trees planted by streams of water. Help us to have good root systems so that we can bear good fruit in our own lives and in the lives of those around us. In Jesus' name, amen.
And that's our show for this week, folks. Thanks for joining us for the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. If you have a question for the show, email steve@spdemme@gmail.com. If you have a question for me, you can reach me at scott@unsocializedmedia.com. Thanks for joining us. Have a great week.